careful, slowly, and it is no secret that I do love power banks. They're not only super handy when it comes to charging up your phone, or nowadays even your laptop, but they're also a perfect fit to power your portable electronics projects. I mean, they provide stable 5 volts, can at least deliver 2 amps of current, they turn off when their batteries are empty to protect them from over-discharge, you can easily charge them up again, they come with a short circuit protection, so there is no way you can destroy them even if you're an electronics beginner, and best of all, you can get them for super cheap. They pretty much only come with one major flaw, which I just recently noticed again. And that flaw is that all power banks turn off automatically if you're only drawing very little current on the outputs, which sadly for me though is quite often with my projects. So now it is finally time to tackle this problem. And in this video, I will not only show you some super simple ways to solve it, but also try out some more advanced hardware hacking, which might be successful. We will see. Let's get started. This video is sponsored by JLC PCB, my favorite PCB manufacturer, who now also offers flexible PCBs. For that, they utilize 100% adhesive-free base material and LDI technology, which ensures that the PCBs are lightweight, thin, super flexible, and can be made into any desired shape and size. If that sounds like your kind of PCB, then check the video description for coupon for free flexible PCB, and upload your first flexible design today to enjoy their awesome quality. Now first off, this auto turn off feature is actually not a bad thing for the average user. You see, the main electronics of a power bank that converts the variable voltage of the batteries into stable 5 volts draws around 30 milliamps while being turned on. That means the batteries of a small power bank could get drained within a month, which is not desirable. And that is why they turn off automatically when only a little or no load is attached, and now it only draws around 0.1 milliamps. And thus, the circuit keeps the battery charged for a long time to come. The only problem is that this current threshold, so that the power banks stay on, can be quite high, and also differs from power bank to power bank. I tested my 4 ones here, and got results of 50 milliamps, 140 milliamps, 40 milliamps, and finally 70 milliamps, which is quite a spread. So no wonder that some of my projects didn't keep the power bank turned on. Which brings us to the first, most simple solution that everyone can use. And it consists of simply using a power bank with a USB-C output. In addition to that, we also need such a power delivery trigger board that you can get for cheap. And all we have to do is connect them, and there you go. We got 5 volts on the USB-A port that will never turn off. And as a bonus, you can select a higher output voltage with a bigger amperage, if your power delivery power bank allows for that. The main disadvantages of this method though are that 2 USB cables are definitely more annoying to deal with than 1, and USB-C power banks are usually a bit more expensive. So time for solution number 2. Which is still super simple, but sadly also super inefficient. For that, we have to solder 2 USB ports onto a piece of perf board, connect their 5V pin and ground pin to one another, check whether everything still works fine, then calculate what resistor we have to add so that we draw 50 milliamps, because I will be using the power bank with the 50 milliamp threshold value. Solder that resistor between 5 volts and ground, plug everything in, and be happy that the power bank will never turn off. The big problem here though, of course, is that we turn the power bank's energy into heat, and considering how much current our small projects require, we basically now got more of a heater than a portable power source. So not ideal yet, but we can step it up a notch with a pull circuit, which will look something like this as a schematic. Now before I explain how it works, let me firstly build it on a piece of perf board, which, let me tell you, was pretty easy to do, took around 30 minutes, and all components in total cost maybe around $2. And the end result looked pretty intriguing in my opinion. So let's plug it into the power bank, adjust this potentiometer here a bit, and bada boom bada bang, the power bank now stays on forever, while only drawing current spikes around every 8 seconds. So the main idea of the circuit is basically attaching a bigger load to the power bank for only a very small amount of time periodically, which, as you can see, is enough to keep it awake. This is possible because of the 555 timer I see, about which I actually did a dedicated video in the past. But as a refresher, this IC can spit out a rectangle voltage signal with adjustable on and off time. The on time is determined by this potentiometer, which I adjusted before, and the off time is determined by this resistor. During the off time, nothing exciting really happens, but during the on time, this LED gets powered and lights up, and this transistor turns on, which lets the bigger necessary current flow. Now I set my current value to 100 milliamps, but feel free to experiment with the current value and on/off time, so that your power bank just barely stays on. So yeah, pretty nifty circuit. And if you're wondering how much energy we save in comparison to before, then let me do a small measurement here with my energy meter. As you can see, with the pulse circuit, we require around 190 microwatt hour in 1 minute. And when going back to the constant load circuit, then it is 2.37 milliwatt hour, which is a difference of 12.5 times more. Not a bad improvement. But what if you don't want to waste any energy at all? Which brings us to the last possible solution, hardware hacking. And before I rip open my lovely power bank right here, let's rather try it first with such a power bank circuit you can get for cheap from the internet. To use it, all you have to do is add one or more lithium batteries to it. And as you can see, it works just like a power bank, including the threshold current value, which in this case is also around 50 milliamps. So the first thing to do when it comes to hardware hacking is obviously understanding the hardware. And for that, I checked the datasheet of the main IC, the IP5328. And while browsing through the 27 pages and checking the application schematic, my main question was of course how this IC measures current. Because that is of course mandatory, in order to know when to turn off its output either due to too little current or too much current. And of course, I quickly found a 10 milliohm resistor sandwiched between the positive and negative sample node of VSys current pin. This resistor is a so-called current shunt, and let's imagine 1 amp of current is flowing to the USB output. The shunt now creates a voltage drop of 1 amp multiplied by 10 milliohm, so around 10 millivolts, which the IC measures across it and thus calculates the flowing current. And that is basically how the current measurement works. And the question is now, how can we trick the IC to think that 50 milliamps, aka the threshold current, is always flowing? I mean, converted into the shunt voltage drop value, that would equal 0.5 millivolts, which we would kind of have to sneak in here somehow. So the first thing I did to try some things out was locating this shunt resistor, making sure what pin connects to what side, and then soldering a wire to the positive side, and later also to the negative side. Next, I probably spent around 3 hours trying things out with voltage dividers, op amps, and even isolated DC power supplies, but nothing worked. At this point though, I finally realized the simplest possible solution. Listen. On this point, we for example got 5 volts. And behind this resistor it is less, like 4.99 volts, if 1 amp is flowing. So what we have to do is cut this connection here. Feed the voltage before into a summing amplifier, which adds the 0.5 millivolts for our 50 milliamp thresholds, and then feed that into the positive sample point. In my theory, that should work. But the problem is, of course, that a 0.5 millivolt op-amp circuit requires lots of precision. And cutting a PCB trace like this is also not simple to do. So at this point, I cancelled this attempt and instead tried something way simpler that other people can try out as well. And that was replacing the 10 milliohm shunt with a homemade 200 milliohm one. This way the voltage drop should be 20 times bigger, meaning the threshold current gets reduced by 20 times, while, of course, the max current also gets reduced this way. And after doing some testing, I can in fact confirm that the input and output max current decreased drastically. And sadly, the output voltage did also take a hit by not being very stable anymore. But on the positive side, I can also say that my low power projects all still functioned, and this time drew enough current to not let the power bank go into standby mode. So yeah, this hack is also not 100% perfect, but I think with all the previous methods I presented in this video, you will hopefully find one that suits your needs, and maybe you also learned something through this video. If so, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!